presentation for which it's not second.
Okay. We'll get started on dynamic optimization methods. So far we have been talking about static optimization, where the goal was to minimize an objective function subject to certain constraints. And it was a one-shot optimization. Once you find the optimal solution, that's it. The job is done. But there are many situations where you want to do an optimization where there is an underlying system that you are trying to optimize. And in that particular system, you have to act over time. Okay, so it's not just acting at a specific instant of time, but you have to, your current action affects the future, and you also have to take actions in the future. So there is a history which couples your action with what the outcome of the overall process is, and you want to optimize that overall outcome. Okay? So typically when you talk about dynamic optimization, there is a state of the system. And then there is an action on the system. And the state and actions are not completely independent. So there is a dynamical equation. So this is state dynamics. Which couples the current state and action to the future state of the system. So typically the performance, before we get to the performance index, let's consider a simple example. You are on a road. Let's say you have three lanes on the road. And Hao and Jianzong cannot answer any questions that I'm going to ask. So you have a road, and you are driving a car. And the car has velocity v. And Vt at time t. And what are the actions? So this is the velocity. And your ut can be either accelerate or brake. Okay? So your velocity is the state of the system. And you can influence the state by taking the action, which is either you can accelerate or you can brake, okay? If you want to make the system more richer, you have velocity which is constrained to 70 miles per hour on a highway, on an Ohio highway. But of course, different places, you will have different velocity limits, speed limits. And at the same time, you could have accelerate at 1 meter per second square, 2 meters per second square, 3 meters per second square, and then again brake at -1 meters per second square, -2 meters per second square, and so on. Okay, so you can have a much more elaborate description of the states of the system as well as the action on the system, and you could have elaborate constraints on the state oblique action of the system. So for instance, you cannot accelerate at 20 meters per second square in a normal car, okay? So there is some constraint on the action in that situation. Certainly you cannot brake at -100 meters per second square in a regular car. So that also adds to certain constraint on the action. And in a regular car, you know, I have a Toyota Corolla, which I've never driven above, okay, maybe it's getting tape recorded, so I shouldn't say. So 70 plus epsilon, I've driven it to 70 miles per hour plus epsilon, where epsilon is a reasonably small quantity. Okay, so, but it has a speedometer, it goes all the way to 150 miles per hour or something, 160 miles per hour. But I've never driven it at that speed. But I'm guessing the velocity cannot go beyond 100 miles per hour in my car, even if I wanted it to. So there are inherent limitations in the system, in the state of the system, or the control action of the system that you can take because of the physics of the underlying system. And you cannot really remove that constraint from the system. Okay, so the state dynamics also contains information about the physics, or some chemistry or biology of the system. So people look at spread of disease in a network. So how many people are infected is the state of the system. What actions you can pick, which is how to inoculate people, how to quarantine people. So that's the action on the system. And then the state dynamics is influenced accordingly. So biology of the system becomes important there. Many chemical processes, so if you're mixing two chemicals, at what rate you should mix them in order to get a certain output from the chemical plant. So that's also something that people study in chemical engineering or in chemistry department, and they use ideas from dynamic optimization in those problems. And certainly in most situations that we would encounter, from civil or mechanical or aerospace or electrical, the state dynamics will be influenced by the underlying physics of the system. So in the case of a car, your VT plus 1 would be VT plus UT delta T. So this is my F of T, VT, and UT. So VT is the state, and UT is the action in this particular system. We note here that VT is not the only state of the system, okay? And I'm going to make some philosophical points from now on, which are very important. So VT is not the only state of the system. The temperature of the interior of the car, that's also a state of the system, okay? The pressure in the engine is also a state of the system, okay? So you can start defining many other states. So temperature, pressure, I don't know, fluid level at time t, the distance traveled so far, so dt. So you can start defining a lot of states of the system. But many of these states will not be influenced by the control action you pick. Okay, so it's important to make the distinction that you could have states in the system that are not influenced by the control action. States not influenced by the action. And then, let's say you have some performance index that you want to minimize. So minimize J of U0, U1, U capital T. So capital T is the terminal time, or T minus 1. So you just want to minimize some performance index, which is given by GT XT plus summation T equals 0 to T minus 1 GT XT UT. Okay, so this is the cost function that I'm picking. So now, so remember, there is a slight change in notation now. FT is the state dynamic, so not an objective function. And the cost function is denoted by GT here in this particular example. Okay? So there are states that are not influenced by the action, and there are states that don't influence the cost. Okay? So to give you an example, the fluid level of the car, let's say you want to get from point A to point B in minimum amount of time. Okay? So this is essentially how much time you're taking to traverse going from point A to point B. And your objective, which is to go in the minimum time, is not really influenced by the fluid level of the car. Okay? Or it's not influenced by how many miles you have traveled in your car so far, which could be 15,000 miles, 70,000 miles, 80,000 miles, and so on. So you have states that are not influenced by action, and you have states that don't influence the cost. And typically, when you are given a problem, a dynamic optimization problem, you have to design what the state of the system is. You have to decide, based on your own intuition, what the state of the system is. And you need to keep in mind to remove states that don't really influence the cost, and perhaps be worried about the states that are not influenced by your action. Because no matter what action you pick, these states are not going to change based on your action. Okay? So that's something you need to keep in mind.
So how this optimization model, or how this performance index is different from the static optimization problem?
So this is, in the static optimization problem, you just had one performance index. So think of it this way. In static problem, you just wanted to minimize. So x0 is given, so x0 is fixed. So let me just erase it from the expression. So in static problem, you just wanted to minimize u0 and u, g0 of u0. That's it.
At one time.
At just one time. That was your objective function. But now you have a sum of objective. And there is a state that couples your current action with what you are going to see in the future. So if you drive slowly now, you will take more time to reach your destination, which is where you want to be at the terminal time step. Okay? Yeah.
Question. You said that the states are not influenced by the action. Do you mean that that's because of the action that we, the way that we are modeling, because of that it's not, or?
It could be because of how you are modeling the system. Or it could be because, it could be because of the physics of the problem itself, where the state is actually completely independent of the action. So for instance, the temperature of the interior of your car is not necessarily influenced by whether you are accelerating or braking. It is an independent system in itself. Okay. However, if you ask people in mechanical engineering, they will say that no, it is still important state, because the amount of power you need to draw from the engine is sum of the power you need to accelerate plus the amount of power that you need to require for running the air conditioning system and doing all other, running the music system, for instance, right? Even that requires power, and that power is drawn from the engine. So, so they worry about how much engine, how much power is required by the engine, and they need to design an optimization for that particular system. And in that system, you do worry about this is a state variable, this is another state variable, this is another state variable, and so on. Okay, because you need to make sure that you have enough power to meet all the demands in the car. So it really depends on the problem to problem what the states of the system should be and what the control action of the system should be. Any question? Yes.
Are there any instances in which instead of a discrete state you have a continuous?
So here it's not discrete state. So you are asking for examples where you have continuous state. So certainly the car example, you have continuous state. If you're sending a spacecraft to the moon or to Mars, that's a continuous state system. What else is continuous? How can I blank on continuous state systems? State of charge, yeah, okay, so, thank you. So in hybrid vehicles, you have the battery capacity, so you have these, well, not just in hybrid system, but also in your phone, you will have your battery until this level, right? So that's a continuous state system. So your battery is at, let's say, 40%, and it can go all the way to 100%, and it can go all the way down to 0%. So that's the state of the system. Okay. Similarly, control action could also be continuous or discrete. So in the case of car, you can accelerate anywhere between minus 10 meters per second square and brake all the way up to minus 5 meters, so minus 20 meters per second square. So that's a continuous action problem. But you could also have discrete action problem where you are just turning on or off the switch. Or you could be, in the case of car, you have gears and they are discrete variables, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and reverse, that's it. So there are situations where you have continuous action and you have situations where you have discrete actions. But whatever we are going to talk about holds more generally. Well, we are going to talk about maximum principle now, which will be in the differentiable, which requires everything to be differentiable. But then I'll talk about what happens when things are non-differentiable. Any other question? In the case of computers nowadays, the state is, you know, so if you think about the AdWords problem, where the issue is that a person comes to your website and you need to figure out which advertisements to pick to display on the screen. So UT is the advertisements you need to pick to display on the screen. What should the XT be? Can anyone think of what the XT should be? What would be the state of the system in that case? User history, right? So you look at the cookies of the user, what websites he or she has visited in the past, and use that information to display ads on the screen, okay? And this is now usually done. And those of you will take 8851, we'll talk about contextual bandits where this kind of system would appear. So XT is the context. So in the computer science, XT would be called the context and UT will be ads or something. What ads to pick to show to the user. And then of course, based on the rewards that you get, so in computer science, people talk more about rewards and less about cost. So this is the cost, we want to minimize it. So the rewards you get is whether the user has clicked on the ad or not. So if it has clicked, you have earned two cents or 5 cents or 20 cents. And that's how you, and you want to maximize that over a long period of time. Okay. Any other question? Okay, so you have a state which is evolving. You have actions that influences the state of the system through this state dynamics. This is something that we cannot change. We cannot influence the dynamics because that comes from the physics, chemistry, or biology of the system. And let's assume that you have a state description and you have the state equation as well as the cost function in terms of the states that are important for that particular system, and you're not considering any irrelevant states in your problem. Then when you are designing a control policy, there are two specific types of control policies you can decide. So, control policies. So policy is a map which maps the state to action. Okay, so policy is a function which maps state to action. And there are two well-known policies, open loop, where gamma t, that maps xt to ut, and gamma t of x is equal to ut for all x in xt. So it's u bar t, okay? So there is a specific action, and no matter what state you pick, the action will be the same, okay? The action is not influenced by the state of the system. So that's an open loop policy. And there is a closed loop policy where gamma t is a function of state x, t. Okay, so your ut is actually a function of the state x, t. And then there are more other types of policies as well, but for the particular form of system that we have picked, this description, these two are the most general forms of policies you can pick. The more complicated policies that you can potentially pick would come in some other class, not in this class. Okay, it's more complicated when you go into stochastic systems, so we're not going to cover that in this class. Anyways, so in the open loop policy, oh, well, I can give you another example. There is another possible policy, which is history dependent policy, where gamma t is a function of x1 to xt. So you see the entire history, all the states that have been, that you have seen until now, and then you pick your action. So that's another policy that you can potentially define, but it will turn out that this closed loop policy could be globally optimal, so you don't have to go to the history dependent policies. So this is sort of useless to carry so much information. Okay, if you get to the university, it doesn't matter how you got into the university, right? So the history, the location that you have visited until now is completely irrelevant as long as you are at the university at this point of time. Okay. So in the next few classes, we are going to talk about how to compute optimal. So you want to minimize this objective function. So we want to talk about how to compute optimal open loop policies and optimal closed loop policies, okay? And open loop policies are certainly easier. So we are going to cover this topic first. And specifically, we want to find optimal open loop U1 star, U2 star, U3 star, all the way up to UT minus 1 star, such that it minimizes this whole objective function. Yes?
We get to pick those small g's,
right? This one? Yes and no. So you can pick, so let's consider a specific physical problem where you want to get to a destination, okay? So it doesn't matter what the running cost is, okay? I don't care about the running cost, I just want to get to a destination. I can pick GT of, let's say the destination's GPS coordinates is D, okay? So I can pick my GT to be XT minus D norm square, okay? Or I can pick it to be e raised to xt minus d, okay? So yes, you can pick the cost function, but you can't really, so it the picking of cost function is influenced by what you want to achieve, okay? So in the case of economic systems, you want to minimize the total cost, whatever that functional form of the cost be. In the case of energy management system, you want to minimize the amount of energy lost, right? So in some cases, this cost function will be given to you. In some cases, you can design the cost function, but you are still restricted. You can't really pick any arbitrary cost function. It has to be in line with the goal that you want to eventually achieve. Okay. In the case of aerospace system, the cost is typically the fuel consumed. Okay. So how much fuel gets consumed from going from Earth to Mars? And the goal always is to minimize the total cost because time is not really the constraint there. So you just don't want to put a lot of mass on the vehicle, not vehicle, what is that called? Rocket. You don't want to put a lot of mass on the rocket, and therefore you want to minimize the total fuel consumed in order to get to the destination. Okay. So let's talk about optimal open loop policy. Let me define the vector u as u0 all the way to ut minus 1. So I have x1 equals to, I should also write that x0 is given, the initial point is given, and t goes from 0 to capital T minus 1. So if I look at x1, it is f of x0 u0. Let me phi 0. Let me write it as, oh, there should be f0 also. Let me define it by a function phi 0 of the entire control set of control actions you have taken during the entire episode. I can write x2 as f1 of x1 u1, which is f1 of f2 of f1 of f0 of x0 u0 u1. So it's a composite map. And it takes into account u0 and u1 and x0. But since x0 is fixed, I'm just going to write it as a function of the entire control trajectory. But it only uses u0 and u1. And I can go on to write xk as phi k of u. No, xk plus 1. I'm thinking whether I should change the index or not. Oh, let me change the index. So this is phi 1, this is phi 2. I want to write xk as phi k of u, and this is independent of u k, uk plus 1, ut minus 1. Okay. Everything's clear until now? Okay. Now we have this objective function, which is a function of this entire vector u0 to ut minus 1. And I have these expressions. And these expressions are essentially constraining the value of x1 and x2 and xk based on the choice of actions that you are going to make, that you have made until now and that you are going to make in the future. Okay, but of course, it's natural because of the way the state transition function is, xk is completely independent of what will happen, what actions you're going to take in the future, because it only depends on what has happened in the past. So then there are two ways to solve this problem. One way is to minimize the objective function subject to constraints. Okay, so these are the constraints. So in this objective function, you use xt and x0, x1, x2, all the way up to xt minus 1. You can treat them as constraints and use Lagrange multiplier theorem to solve the problem. This is a way to suppress the dynamic nature of the problem and turn it into a static problem. Okay? So one way to do the static formulation is I want to minimize this objective function subject to x1 equals to phi 1 u, x2 equals to phi 2 u, xt equals to phi t u. Okay. Oh, this is minimization with respect to u as well as with respect to x. But certainly x is only appearing in the constraint, it doesn't appear in the objective function. Okay. So that's one way of doing it. Yes.
So in order to actually be able to do that, it has to be discrete, right?
Which has to be discrete?
Like in that static formulation. Like we need a certain, we need like a countable number of constraints, right?
Not really. So if I want to minimize x squared such that x plus 1 is less than equal to 2, or x plus 1 is equal to 2, I mean, you don't need this to be discrete. You don't need x to be discrete. And in this case, you don't need x or u to be discrete. By the way, I'm going to assume that all of it is Rn. So xt is in Rn, ut is in Rm. So I'm going to still use capital Xt to denote the space and ut to denote the control action space, but they are all Euclidean spaces. We don't want to get into more complicated constraints right now. This is complicated enough. Yes?
So we just need little t needs to be discrete, though.
Yeah, we want the little t to be discrete, yes, for sure. So were you asking about the little t, or were you asking about the state space itself? Oh, sorry. So yeah, little t has to be discrete, but the state space can be continuous. However, one thing you should notice is that there are t equality constraints, and something that we have done in the past, when you have equality constraint, you can actually eliminate variables, and you can put everything in the objective function itself. Okay, so let's try and do that. In which case, let me make a simplification first. Let me erase the running cost, so we don't have any running cost, we only have terminal cost. So in that case, I can actually simplify this problem significantly. So let's consider case one. Gt is identically zero. So then the problem becomes minimize G capital T, P capital T of U. So I've eliminated all the constraints, and I've written Xt purely as a function of U itself, okay? And this u is in u0 cross u capital T minus 1, but it still remains a Euclidean space. Okay, it's t copies of Rm multiplied to each other. How can we solve this problem? Just take the gradient. We can apply the usual gradient descent algorithm to solve this problem. So we start with some, let me denote by superscript. You start with u0 arbitrarily, and you define Okay, so this is the gradient descent algorithm for this problem, terminal time problem. Yeah.
So t equals zero for all t doesn't equal to.
So for all t, in 0 to capital T minus 1. Running cost is 0. So this is the gradient descent algorithm, and we want to efficiently implement this algorithm. And in order to efficiently implement it, we need to compute this derivative. And it doesn't look that it's easy to compute it, right? It turns out that it's actually easy to compute. We just need to unravel this particular equation. Okay, so let's unravel this derivative equation in the rest of this class. I want to get to, I want to try and get to the final result, which is this. So once you unravel this derivative, and you come up with a much more easy to see equation, that equation is known as backpropagation algorithm, okay? And that equation is used, that algorithm is used for training neural networks for many, many years, and it's also used heavily in a lot of car engines nowadays for optimizing the emissions and optimizing the battery consumption and so on. Okay. So this is backpropagation algorithm. So let's look at gradient of u of this gt composition phi t is actually gradient with respect to u0 of gt composition phi t, gradient with respect to ut minus 1 of gt composition phi t. Okay, so this is a composition of two functions. So we can compute this gradient if we compute each of these things. So let's try and do that. Let's compute the final one first. And I want to write an identity on the board. So gradient of F composition gx is, anyone remembers what this? Gradient of gx multiplied by gradient of f evaluated at gx. So this is dimensionally correct, okay? Gradient with respect to x. So I'm going to use that formula here to get gradient of ut minus 1 phi t multiplied by gradient of gt evaluated at phi t of u. Okay. So let me write this as gradient with respect to x capital T, because gt is a function of xt. So this gradient should be should be with respect to y, and the y is going to take the value gx here. So I'm going to do the same thing here. Okay? So I guess now everything looks correct. I am going to substitute phi t now. So that's gradient of ut minus 1, ft minus 1, xt minus 1, ut minus 1, multiplied by gradient of xt, g capital T. This term doesn't depend on ut minus 1, okay? So I don't need to take derivative with respect to xt minus 1 anymore. Okay. Any questions so far? So everything looks straightforward. So we had a dynamic problem. We suppressed the dynamic nature of the problem, eliminated some terms to come up with a very simplified problem. On this simplified problem, we realize that it's just a usual gradient descent problem, so we need to compute. So if we apply the gradient descent algorithm, we can converge to locally optimal solution, assuming some special structure on the cost function. But the problem here is that this derivative seems very difficult to compute because it involves quite a bit of composition of functions. So we want to somehow simplify the computation of the derivative. We realize that the derivative can be written in this particular format. Let's look at the final derivative, and using the derivative of composition of function, we arrived at this particular expression for the derivative with respect to ut minus 1. I can do the same thing for derivative with respect to ut minus 2 of this, but now the problem is that ut minus 2 influences xt minus 1, and xt minus 1 influences phi t, or rather if xt minus 1 influences my xt, x capital T. So there is a lot of dependence going on here. So let's see how to unravel that. So this is gradient of ut minus 2 gt of ft minus 1 ft minus 2 xt minus 2 ut minus 2 ut minus 1 and so on. So this term doesn't depend on ut minus 2. This term doesn't depend on ut minus 2. So I can just view this as composition of three functions of ut minus 2. And the derivative will be so derivative with respect to the innermost function of that variable, this doesn't depend on ut minus 2, so it doesn't matter. So I take the derivative with respect to ft minus 2, then I take the derivative of ft minus 1 with respect to xt minus 1, because this is xt minus 1, and ut minus 2 doesn't influence ut minus 1. So I take derivative with respect to xt minus 1, and then finally I take the derivative of gt with respect to xt. Okay? And now we'll look for a pattern in this derivative. Anyone sees a pattern? So the first term in this derivative is derivative with respect to ut minus 1 for that corresponding function, the state transition function. So we see the same thing here. And then the final term is derivative with respect to xt, And so in the middle, you have derivative with respect to all the states for all the transition functions in between. Okay? And that's exactly the pattern you will see if you continue this calculation, which you can use induction to prove. So gradient of ut of gt, no, g capital T composition phi capital T is actually okay, so this is the derivative. Okay. Now this derivative is also very ugly, but there is also another structure in this derivative. So let's try to identify that particular structure. I'm going to define it as pt plus 1, and I'm going to call it co-state vector. So I define my co-state vector in the following fashion. Pt is gradient xt multiplied by gt. Pt is gradient xt ft multiplied by pt plus 1. So that's my update equation for the co-state vector. But it's updated in a recursive fashion, in a backward induction fashion. Okay? So you define your pt first, and then you define pt minus 1, pt minus 2, and so on. And now we can write the gradient of ut of gt composition GT composition FT as PT plus 1 transpose, no, actually dimensionally it should be gradient of PT plus 1. Okay. Questions?
So in each step of the value propagation, you basically compute the del xt ft.
Yes. So this is the there is a forward propagation and then a backward propagation. So the forward propagation is for every u or uk, or let's, for every u, you compute x, so x0 is given, so you compute x1 to x capital T using the state dynamics equation. That's the forward propagation step. Forward propagation. Then you compute the co-state vector starting from gradient of xt gt evaluated at this particular xt. Okay? So this is, you compute the pt and then you compute all the way up to P0 or P1. That's the backward propagation. So you feed this x0, u0, xt minus 1, ut minus 1, and x capital T, feed it to the pt recursion to get p capital T minus 1, all the way up to p0. And this is known as backward propagation. Yes?
I thought little t only went up to t, capital T minus 1, right?
Little t will go all the way up to t minus 1. But at t minus 1, you have ft minus xt equals to ft minus 1, xt minus 1, ut minus 1. So this goes all the way up to xt. OK. So at every step, so you want to compute this derivative in order to run the gradient descent algorithm. So how would you run the gradient descent algorithm? You need to compute each of these individual components of this particular giant vector. So the way to do it in a recursive fashion is for a given initial state and for the current set of control actions you have, you compute all the states using the state transition function. That's the forward propagation part. Then you use this entire trajectory, feed it into the PT recursion, the co-state recursion, to get the values of PT all the way up to P0. That's the backward propagation. And then by multiplying gradient of UT to FT dot PT plus 1, so this is the usual, this is a matrix, this is a vector, so it's a usual multiplication. Matrix multiplied by a vector, and then you plug that in here, okay? And storing all these values allows you to write a recursive equation for each of these gradients, and then you use the usual gradient descent. Pick an appropriate step size. You can pick whatever rule you want, Armijo's rule, decreasing step size, constant step size, and so on, and you can run the gradient descent algorithm. When will the gradient descent algorithm converge? If it leads to a contraction map, okay? So if it is a contraction map, it will converge. If this is convex, this overall function, the composition of two functions is convex, you will converge to the global minimum of the problem. Now the answer you get from this backpropagation algorithm would be U star so back propagation yields U star. Okay, this U star doesn't depend on the state, it's just a fixed sequence of actions you need to take. So think of this open loop strategy as, so what you get is an optimal open loop policy. So think of it this way. You ask me where is Starbucks, and I tell you, go straight 50 meters, take a right turn, walk for 20 minutes, and then take a left turn, and then go 50 meters again. And you close your eyes, and then you just execute that sequence of actions, 50 steps, take a right turn, 50 steps, take a left turn, 50 steps. That's an open loop policy. That's an optimal open loop policy. What's the problem with this policy? Sorry?
We need to know the final answer so that back propagation could work.
No, the back propagation still works, and it yields an optimal open loop policy. And the open loop policy is 50 steps, right turn, 50 steps, left turn, 50 steps. What's the problem with this policy?
It has to be differential.
No.
It's agnostic of state.
Sorry? Not a function of state, yeah. So why is that a problem?
State changes.
Sorry? Why would the state change? It's a completely deterministic system. So you don't know you reach the destination or not. Well,
step sizes will change.
So this one, so the backpropagation says this is the optimal path you need to take. And the problem is that the open loop policy doesn't account for the environmental uncertainties that would appear once you start executing the control process. Okay, so you thought that I'm going to put this much fuel in the rocket and I'm going to have stage one, stage two, stage three, and so on. And when the time for rocket launch starts, there is a high wind gust of 20 meters per second. Okay? That's an uncertainty that you hadn't accounted for at the very beginning. When you started, when you designed the control action. So now the problem is, the problem is that every time you decide an open loop policy, it will be under some environmental condition. But when you actually execute that plan, it will not be in the same environmental situation. So the situation may change. And that's why open loop policies are not very useful. So time is up. Oh, okay. We'll take the discussion from here in the next class. And we'll discuss why closed loop policy is better. Thank you.
意思就是一次。